Tonight, we're continuing with our topic on mountains. Say mountains. I told you before that there are certain things in the Bible, they're very spiritual. However, in the natural world, these things remain natural. For the Bible says, for he that is natural, all things are natural. And he that is spiritual, all things are spiritual. Now, if all things are spiritual, to he that is spiritual, it actually means that. And to those who are natural, all things are natural. So when we are dealing with these issues, you may actually not know what we're talking about. All right, so for you to understand what we're talking about, when we speak about the mountains, what are these issues? What are we talking about? What are we talking about? So when we speak about, okay, we are praying against every mountain, we have people who don't even know the meaning of mountains. All right, now I want us to check the scripture. We'll be going into the book of Zechariah, chapter 4, verse 7. Who art thou, O great mountain? Now, we see here the word mountain that is being used there is not a typical mountain, a physical mountain that each one of you do know. Who art thou, O great mountain, before Zerubbabel? Who art thou, mountain? It says, before Zerubbabel, thou shalt become a plain, and he shall bring forth the headstone thereof with a shouting, crying, grace, grace unto it. Now, when we go into NIV, and I want you to hear this, the translation says, what are you, mighty mountain? Before Zerubbabel, you will become level ground. Now, before I continue, I want to remind you again, and I want each of us to agree that the mountain the Bible is talking about here is not the physical mountain, but the spiritual mountain. Do you agree on that? Yes. So the Bible here is not talking about the physical mountain you see. No, he isn't talking about that. That's what the Lord is saying here. The address is talking about a spiritual mountain. What was this mountain? So we have to first of all understand what was happening here. Now, the word Zerubbabel is a survivor. A survivor of those who were in Babylon. These were foreigners in Babylon. The word is Zerubbabel. It's Zeru and Babel. Babel comes from the word Babylon. Zeru, which means a foreigner. Babylon, which means a country. And the word Babylon, it doesn't mean a nation as say. It actually means a land of confusion. So when we say Zerubbabel, we mean a foreigner in the land of confusion. Because Babylon means land of confusion. Zeru means a foreigner. So there were people there was a moment when the people of Israel were in Babylon as slaves. And there were those who were contaminated into the system of the people of Babylon. They were doing what the people of Babylon were doing. So they were part and parcel of the system of Babylon. And yet they were not supposed to. They were slaves in Babylon, and they were supposed to maintain their faith in God, in Yahweh. But some of them defected from their faith. And some said, no, we will not defect our faith into other gods. The likes of Daniel, Meshach, Abednego. They said, we will not. We will live here as foreigners. And these are the ones being addressed as Zerubbabel. Well, come on. Somebody said, I hear you, prophet.
I hear you, prophet.
So if we speak now, we understand that. So the land of confusion, it was Babylon. But now, if you read the book of Revelation, Babylon will no longer be in where it was, because today, the modern Babylon of today is Iraq. So in the book of Revelation, Babylon is no longer a location. It is the whole world. The whole world now has become a land of confusion. The whole world has become a Babylon. I'm talking to somebody right here. So in the book of Revelation, now the world is Babylon. It is the land of confusion. So if you live in this world as a foreigner, you are a Zerubbabel. Mm-hmm. Now the scripture addresses you, saying, what is a mountain before you? You shall level it ground. Okay, I'm talking to people now. So if you are a foreigner, if you act, if you live, if you do not believe like how they believe, if you don't live like they live, if you don't see as they see, where they see a problem, you see a solution. Where they see fear, you see faith. Where others are running, you actually see a solution. Because your attitude is not of the people of this world. You are not a citizen of this Babylonian system. You are of God. That's why the book of Romans 12 says what? Do not be confounded to the pattern of this world. Do not be confounded. Do not be contaminated. In Romans 12 verse 2, do not conform to the pattern of this world. What's the pattern of this world? When a person is hurt, everybody else cries. They get depressed. They go through problems. You know, this is the pattern that if this thing happens, this is what happens. The bastards do not conform into that system. Amen. Come on, somebody say, I'm not going to do that. So the Bible says, do not be conformed. In other words, when people get sick, they get sick and their sickness affects them until they die. Now it says, if you are of God, it says, do not be conformed to the pattern. Meaning if you are sick, your sickness must lead you to the glory of God. You must find your healing through your sickness. If you are in trouble, your trouble should not take you into the end of you. Your trouble should take you out of your solution. Because you are not in the pattern how things go in the world. We are of God. Am I talking to somebody here? So when the scripture says Zerubbabel, it means those people who make a choice to say we will not be conformed to the system, to the pattern, how things are done in the world. Someone say, I hear you, prophet. We have people like, in the name of Jesus Christ, every mountain move. It's not for every person to make those prayers of saying, move mountain, move, I command. No. It is for those who decide. It's for those who decide to say, I will not think like anyone. I will not see things like anyone. I will think differently. I will see things different. It says, if you are like that, you shall say to any mountain, even if the mountain is a mighty mountain, you shall say to that mountain, be moved, and it shall be moved. Let's go to Matthew 17. All right, let me just show you Matthew 17. Okay, we are seeing another story there. I love this. Where Jesus finds a demon, a spirit, and he commands it out. After commanding it out, people come and say, how did you cast it out? He says, oh, that spirit is like a mountain. In fact, that problem was a mountain. So he is likening, comparing a demonic spirit and entity to a mountain. How many mountains you have? There are so many mountains. And you better know what I'm talking about. Because we have to move these mountains tonight. Yes. We have to command these mountains out of your way. Hear this, what the scripture says. And I want you to hear this. In the book of Matthew 17, let's start from verse 14. The Bible here reads, okay. When they came to the cloud, a man approached Jesus and knelt before him. Lord, have mercy on my son. He said, he has what?
Seizures. seizures
and is suffering greatly. He often falls into the fire or into the water. I brought him to your disciples, but they could not heal him. They could not. Listen, these mountains don't respond to everyone. It was a mountain. The disciples had not graduated into a certain realm of Zerubbabel, where they are foreigners. Tell your neighbor, I'm not just like anyone else. Some are foreigner here. Say, that's why I don't care. Say, I move by the Spirit of God. So I brought him to your disciples, and they could not heal him. Which disciples? We're talking about Apostle Peter. We're talking about Apostle John, who wrote the book of Revelation. We're talking about who? Andrew. Bartholomew. We're talking about James. We're talking about Judas. And another Judas who betrayed Jesus. We're talking about Thomas. All of them together. Out. A mountain could not move. And it's like the story with your life. You are casting and commanding mountains, and the mountains are silent. You must learn the secret tonight. Because when they asked Jesus, why couldn't we cast out? Jesus began to teach them about mountains. When they asked to say, why couldn't we? Jesus immediately began a sermon teaching them about spiritual mountains. So I'm also teaching you about spiritual mountains tonight. So the mountains can move tonight.
Yes.
Every mountain is going to move in the name of Jesus Christ. If you believe, raise your right hand as I believe. Now let's go ahead. The Bible here says, you unbelieving and perverse generation. Jesus replied, how long shall I stay with you? How long shall I put up with you? Bring the boy here to me. I love this. He said, bring the boy to me. Even you tonight, if you have mountains and you are struggling to cast them out, bring them to me. Let's see if that mountain will stay. Now I promise you it will not. You are dealing with Zerubbabel here. I don't think like they think. Now let's go ahead. Another scripture here says, Jesus rebuked the demon and it came out of the boy, and he was healed at that moment. Verse 19 is my most important place. Then the disciples came to Jesus in private and asked, why couldn't we drive it out? I keep on telling you, sometimes meet the prophet in private and say, but I'm coming to IVP to ask. It says, why couldn't we? At least we are humble enough. I have so many people around me who don't even ask to say, Papa, why can't I prophesy? Why can't I cast out? They just look at me. Why couldn't we cast out? That's a simple question. Why couldn't we? We tried, all of us. And the spirit could not come out. The more they were saying out, the more the seizures were becoming worse. And don't blame God on this one. There are people who blame God to say, I've been praying, nothing is happening, I've been praying. Jesus said, you have no faith. Simple. The answer was so simple, direct. That's the answer. Let's read it. Why couldn't we drive it out? Verse 20, what did Jesus Christ say? He replied, because you have so little faith. You have what?
So little faith.
No matter how you want to try to please me, to say, my father, oh prophet, oh, I believe, I have so much faith, but my situation is not changing. Go and believe more. I promise you, just go and believe more. Go and believe more. I promise you, the problem we're dealing here with is little faith. For you even to come and tell me to say, I've been praying and nothing is changing, is little faith. Just that fact, you're able to say, I've been praying and nothing is changing. If you are saying nothing is changing, so what will change? That's a little faith. So Jesus looks at them and says what? He says, you of little faith. Who is he talking to? Remember, this was a private meeting. So he's not speaking to other people. He's talking to his disciples. He says, you of little faith. How long shall I be with you? How could you not cast out a spirit? How could you not get a financial breakthrough? And you still know how it's like, oh, I'm waiting for upon the hand. In fact, maybe even the disciples had even encouraged the parent to say, don't worry. One day your child will be okay. You know, let's keep on praying. God's time is the best. Shut up. I don't want you to believe God for my life will open one day. I don't want you to believe God for that's nonsense. It is a lie from the pit of hell. Your life is turning around now. The devil keeps on encouraging you to say, don't worry. You know, you have time. It will happen. When? Say now.
Now.
Don't hear that lie of the enemy to say, don't worry. No, we are believing God now. If I wake up tomorrow, I'll still believe God to say it's now. If I wake up the other day, I'll still talk about it now. Until I see it happening. That's faith. So if I say out, if I say come out to a spirit, they say come out to a spirit. And then I come and I say, I didn't come out. I want you to see this. This is getting interesting. See this. What is Jesus saying here? He replied, because you have so little faith. Simple. The reason why you're not getting that breakthrough, the reason why that miracle is delaying, no matter how you may encourage yourself, is faith. It's a faith. The answer is faith. The answer is faith. Faith. Can you imagine Elijah was praying on a mountain? People think he was a prophet. And no! Get this. The man was praying on a mountain and there were no clouds. And the man was praying. And then he says, go and check if there's a cloud. Because he actually told himself that I will not open my eyes. Because checking in the sky, you can just check yourself. Why was he sending someone to check? Because he decided the moment I will see, my faith will be affected. So he told himself, I'm not opening my eyes. Check. He says, there is nothing. He prays. He says, check. He says, there is nothing. And this, the seventh time he says, what do you see? He says, there is actually nothing. It's just a small cloud like a hand. If you learn science at school, those clouds are known as cumulonimbus. And they don't bring rain. But Elijah saw rain in the cumulonimbus. He says, what? He says, I have seen a small cloud like a hand. He says, I hear abundance of rain. He says, tell the king to start running because he will get soaked with the rain. Say, king, Elijah says, begin to run. Imagine making the king run and then it doesn't rain. The way he will kill you. He says to the king, he says, king, he says, begin to run because there is rain. He says, king looked up. There were no clouds. So the king began to run. But you can see that he wasn't even running fast because he never believed it. Can you imagine he was using a chariot and Elijah began to run using his legs. And he was able to run and overtook the king. And the Bible says the rain hit him. By the time he was arriving at the gate, there was rain. Tell me, what is this? Just tell me, what is this? There was nothing like we're waiting on God. The clouds will come. Hallelujah. Praise be to God. Hallelujah. The rains will come. Keep on waiting. Are you crazy? I need a miracle now. I need a breakthrough. I need deliverance. I need. And something has to happen. I'm in trouble. I need a turnaround now. I don't want to wait for another day. I need something to happen. Now. You tell me. Jesus said, you have little faith. You have little faith. Can you imagine Jesus is coming from the mountain and he's praying, and then he finds that the disciples are in the boat and they are leaving him. And then there is the ocean starts from here. The sea starts from here. And he's coming from the mountain. The Bible says when he was coming from the mountain, when he saw them there, he just came and continued on the water, walking, going. Meaning to say that he never even said, Father, in the name of Jesus, I command the water become solid. There was no even thinking to say, I will sink. He just came from the mountain, just like this, and just joined. The moment he just thought about it, he would sink. Peter, too, he said, if you are the Messiah, can I come? He said, come. He began to walk. The moment he saw the water, he began to sink. The moment he began to see the water, the moment you begin to see your trouble, you will sink. The moment you begin to see what you're passing through, you will sink. Don't see the situation. Don't see the storms around you. Don't see the winds around you. Keep on seeing your Messiah. You will walk on this water. Somebody shout amen.
Amen.
Listen to me. We have faith. That's the only thing God left us with. He said, if you believe, all things are possible. We only have faith. We have nothing else. It's not angels that will cover you. It's a faith. Faith will bring down angels. Faith will bring down the rain. Faith will bring down the fire. Faith will bring down intervention. Faith is the raw material we have. Somebody say, I hear you, prophet. Now watch this. So Jesus says, it is because they're asking him in private. They say, why couldn't we remove the spirit? He says, it is because you do not have. Now let's read it. It says, he replied, because you have so little faith. Truly, I tell you, if you have faith as small as a mustard seed, you can say to this mountain. Now, wait a minute. He says, it is because you have how big faith? Little faith. Then he says, if you have faith as small as a mustard seed. Now, the mustard seed is too small, meaning that their faith was actually little, wasn't even getting to a mustard seed, and yet they thought they had faith. This is my problem now. I have people in this room, and even others watching, who think they have so much faith. But if God can put it on the scale, it is too little. It can't even match the mustard seed. And they were apostles. Apostles of God. Apostles also. Wearing a gown. And they didn't know that their faith was too little. It wasn't even as small as a mustard seed. That is the sermon that changed these disciples. From this day, check their lives. From this day, check their lives. All they needed was this sermon.
Yes, sir.
Let's continue reading. It says, if you have what?
Little
faith as small as a mustard seed, you can say to this
mountain.
Mountain. Which mountain? He's not comparing that demon to a mountain. So they are spiritual mountains. But these spiritual mountains require what? Faith. For you to command them. They require you to be a Zerubbabel, a foreigner in a land of confusion. Where there are confusions, be a foreigner. Amen. Don't be conformed to the confusion happening around you or with you. Be a foreigner to them. Are you here?
Yes.
Do you know why people make mistakes in the world markets? Why people make losses when they're trading on all platforms, stock markets and all other trading platforms? It is because when they read a newspaper to say this month in America looks like there's so much hope into the economy, people invest into different products and then the economy goes down. It goes opposite what they had predicted, and then they make losses. They make losses. When they say, no, a lot of people are pulling off their money from the markets. Looks like this. Everyone begins to pull off the markets. Even if someone says, I will not trade it today. People are removing the, and that's the day people make money. It always goes opposite. And sometimes it's not opposite. But mostly it's opposite. Because only moments when we as believers can make things happen is when we are opposite of the world, opposite of the situation. When everyone thinks we are afraid, we have faith. Are you here?
Yes.
I told you last time that Paul was singing in the prison. Who praises God in trouble? Paul and Silas were singing in prison. And they were to be slaughtered the following day. You need to understand this. They had commanded the spirit to come out from a little girl. And they were arrested and put in prison. And you must know why they were put in prison. Because the whole business of the area collapsed. Because that young girl was giving them fortunes. And when they were in prison, they began to sing songs of praise. What happens in your prison? Your panic, depression. You even think, why has God left me? Why didn't Paul say, why has God left us? But they were worshiping amidst crisis. And God came down for them. And prisons opened because they did not panic in trouble. Do not be conformed to the pattern of what you're passing through. Do not be conformed to the pattern of the situation happening around you. Hear me. Be a foreigner to the situation. Be a foreigner to the confusion. So I hear you, prophet.
I hear you, prophet.
Now, I want you to see this. So he says, you shall say to this mountain, be you removed. This is Jesus. Now, I spoke to you a service prior. Types of mountains. We looked at a mountain called what? Ararat. I told you that this mountain Ararat, spiritually, it is a mountain where people get stuck. Now, are you here, somebody?
Yes.
Mount Ararat in the Bible, it is a mountain where things get stuck. I can give you more references in the scripture, but it's a place where things get stuck. In fact, even the ark, the ship, which the Bible speaks in the days of what? In the days of Noah, when he took all animals, everything, and put in this, and there were floods happening for 40 days and nights. Guess what? It got stuck on Mount Ararat. After all that miracle of survival, you get stuck on Mount Ararat. There are people who are passing through this mountain experience. A miracle happened in their life, but their miracle is stuck. Their miracle is stuck somewhere. They don't know how to come out. In fact, a miracle happened. It's not like it didn't happen. It happened. But that miracle is stuck. There's no movement, no one, but it's a big miracle. But it's just stuck. May you come out of this experience. The second mountain we looked at was Mount what? Mount Horeb. Mount Horeb is also known as Mount Sinai. Okay? It is a mountain where what happened? It is a mountain where Moses encountered the burning bush. And it is a place where he knew God. He knew God as a holy God. It is at this mountain. It is also known as Mount Sinai, okay? Please remember this. It is also known as Mount Sinai. It is a place where when he met this mountain, he met God. He went into different mountains. He never met God. But when he comes to Mount Horeb experience, you meet God. This mountain, spiritually, is a good mountain. You don't get stuck here. At this mountain, you know God. You meet God. You know your calling. Moses knew his calling at Mount Horeb. When God is taking you to know your calling, just know that he has put you at Mount Horeb experience. You are understanding things because God has put you at Mount Horeb. Not only that, when they were coming back from Egypt, going to Canaan, they passed through this mountain, and the Bible says there was no water. And the people of Israel were thirsty, and they needed water. And in Moses, God taught him what to do. So he went at Mount Horeb and he hit a rock and water came out. And the water that came out from there, in the book of 1 Corinthians 10 from verse 4, it says actually that rock was Jesus. And did all drink the same spiritual drink, for they drank of that spiritual rock that followed them. And that rock was Christ. So imagine this, that Jesus Christ was there before the beginning of the earth. And I think we all know that. He wasn't just born in the New Testament. Jesus was already there. But he was sent, like this time around, he was sent as a rock. In Israel, he was sent as a son of God. So the Bible says that rock was Christ that followed them. So at Mount Sinai or Horeb, you meet Christ. You drink from Christ. It is a mountain where you have an experience, where you have thirsty. You need God. There are moments when you want to feel like, I just want to worship God. I just want to pray. I just want to hear my father teach. I just want to hear the prophet teach. I just want to read the Bible. I just want to get some moment. I just want to fast. If this is happening to you, God has taken you to a level of Mount Horeb experience. Because people at this mountain are thirsty. People at this mountain meet God. God tells them, take off your shoes. The place you are standing is a holy ground. It is a place of an experience with Jehovah. Amen. Say amen. Amen. Now, let's go ahead. So after we spoke about this mountain, we went to another mountain in the Bible. And what mountain was that? Mount Hor. It is a mountain where people lose their callings. At Hor, people lose their callings. And also, people die. People die. And we have, listen to me, we have a whole great man of God. God says to him, he says, Aaron, go to Mount Hor. He says, to do what is it? To die. So he goes there. God says, hey, but before you die, can you remove the garment? So he removed the priestly garment. The moment he removed it, he died. At this place, I told you before, there are people today, now, as I'm talking to you, they are losing their calling. Whatever garment God gave you, some of you, God gave you garments as intercessors. Some of you, God gave you garments as preachers, teachers. Some of you, garments as kingdom financials, to support the kingdom financially. Be careful, because God can take away his garment. And when he takes away the garment, whatever you are doing will collapse. Because the reason why you had that garment was for you to use the garment for your calling. And the people here lose callings. We won't talk scriptures today. We already spoke scriptures. At Mount Hor, people lose calling. And you won't even notice that you have lost the calling. Until it's dead. That intercessory spirit is no longer there now. It died. He used to pray. He used to intercede. He used to, you know, have this, you know, zeal, passion to intercede. It's no longer there. It's gone. You had a zeal to be preaching, to be teaching. It's no longer there. You had a zeal to be praying, watching the services. That passion is going slowly because you are moving at this experience of Mount Hall. May God protect you. In the name of Jesus, I refuse this experience. And after we spoke this mountain, we went into another mountain. And we spoke about what mountain? Mount Gilboa. It is a mountain of what? It is a place where people receive curses. In fact, when I was teaching you that day, I didn't even tell you a lot. In fact, it's one mountain, but with the two divisions. The other side is called Gerizim. And the other side is called Gibor. It is a place where curses are uttered. And I tell you, never allow yourself to find yourself over this experience. Well, I told you, what happened on this mountain? What happened in this mountain? Anointed man of God was slain. What are you doing over this mountain? How anointed you may be, just don't go into some other experiences. Some other places are dangerous. You can be slain. And when King Saul went over this mountain, he was killed. Not only him, with his children. Jonathan died. And David said, no rain, no dew shall fall over this mountain until today. If rain is raining in Israel, it surrounds this mountain because it is a cursed mountain. It is a cursed mountain. Cursed. When you are in this experience in the life of Gilboa, I'm telling you the truth. There is no rain. Even if you do something, you will not see harvest. There is no dew. There is no rain. There is drought. Your bank account, drought. Your life, drought. Everything is dead, dried. You operate from a dry moment. You do not need this experience. May God set you free from this experience. If you're facing a Gilboa experience, I speak as Jesus said, you shall say to this mountain, be you moved. And I said to that mountain, be you moved in the name of Jesus. Say, I move this mountain. I remove this mountain. I remove Gilboa. In the name of Jesus. At this mountain, destinies are slain. You need to know who died there. He was a king. At this mountain, people lose hope. They lose careers. Things are slain here. Kingships are slain. Destinies are slain. Anointings are slain. Businesses are slain. Destroyed at this place of curses. May none of these curses affect you in the name of Jesus. I say in the name of Jesus. And then we saw another mountain. Mount Carmel. What is Mount Carmel? Mount Carmel, it is a mountain. It's not just, you know, when we hear about Mount Carmel, people just say Elijah called for fire. Hey, you don't know what you're talking about. What happened for fire to come? That's the problem we have. For fire to come, what was it? Who was he challenging? Magicians. At this experience, the enemy targets you with people to finish you up. And when you are at Mount Carmel, you have opponents. People who are dedicated to make sure you are finished. Both physical and spiritual. Elijah was dealing with Jezebel physically like this at that mountain. Apart from that, there were 400 witch doctors. I didn't say 400 people. 400 witch doctors. And he's dealing with army commanders. He's dealing with the security system. He's dealing with the queen, Jezebel, physically there. She's sitting there. The husband is sitting there. The army is sitting there. At the very same time, magicians are sitting there. All of them want to deal with one man. And some of you are passing through that right now. There are people who are dedicated to bring you down. And some of you are being monitored by witchcraft, satanic manipulations. And some of you, there is a woman the enemy has raised to finish you up. But the good news is, can I tell you the good news? At Mount Carmel, the moment you don't give up, God is willing even to release fire from heaven. Ah, you didn't hear me. I said God is even willing, as long as you want to give up, he's willing to even bring the fire. Not only fire, he can also make it rain. If it will rain, the rain will fall. If it will rain, miracles. If it will rain, fire. If it will rain, a breakthrough. At Mount Carmel, it is a place you are tested. Will you still stand? The enemy tests you here. He uses all weapons. You are attacked from the land, from the sea, and from the air. The enemy is fighting from every angle. As you are fixing this, another battle is coming. As you are fixing this, another war is coming. It is a place you must never give up. The moment you give up, you are finished. In fact, Jezebel loved the competition. She said, let's see. He said, if you lose Elijah, we are killing you now. So they made a bet to say the one that will lose must be killed. That's why Elijah killed all 400 witch doctors, because they lost to him. He said, oh, we made a bet. So let's kill these 400 witch doctors. But it's a place where you should not make a mistake of saying, oh, I'm giving up. Or you will be finished. Because the enemy is dedicated to finish you. Someone raise your hand and say, in the name of Jesus, let fire fall. Let rain come. Let miracles fall. I speak divine protection. Tell the neighbor next to you, say, this mountain will be removed. How many here can sense that they are at Carmel? How many are saying, prophet, I'm having battles from all corners. I sense that there is a Carmel experience, but I'm not losing my faith. It's going to rain here. It's going to rain fire. It doesn't matter how many the enemy is trying to mobilize against you. Trust me, with your eyes, you shall see them one by one falling. I can promise you this. You shall see them falling. It doesn't matter how many they are, what weapons they are using, whether they're using false lies, anything they're trying to use, manipulation, witchcraft, and every demonic entity they can use in the world, you will become the Elijah at the end of the day. You are at Mount Carmel. At this mountain, everything can happen. So people, all they do, they just see the 400 witch doctors, the Jezebel. Oh, I'm passing through our Lord. Shut up. There is a fire. He just tried to say fire. You will see fire fall. Don't just see the enemy. There is also fire coming there. They just don't know you. They don't know you. I promise you. They just don't know you. In the first place, they don't know where you are coming from. Since you were a child, they don't know how many battles you have gone through, how many things God has done to make you what you are today. So you can't lose now. Are you there? Now, after that, we spoke about what mountain? Oh, we stopped on that mountain? Today, we'll be talking about Mount Pisgah. The most, the whole Bible, it is the most controversial mountain. Say Pisgah. Are you here? Are you here, somebody? Yes. So I'm here, prophet. You ready for this? All right, so let's go into the book of Deuteronomy 34 from verse 1 and to where I tell you to stop. And Moses went out from the plains of Moab and to the mount of Nebo, to the top of Pisgah. Mm-hmm. Now you have an idea now. Mm-hmm. That is over against Jericho. And the Lord showed him all the land of Gilead and to Dan. On what mountain?
Pisgah.
And all Naphtali. And all the land of Ephraim and Manasseh. And all the land of Judah at the utmost sea. Mm-hmm. And the south and the plain of the valley of Jericho, the city of palm trees, unto Zoar. And the Lord said unto him, this is the land which I swear unto Abraham, unto Isaac, unto Jacob, saying, I'll give it unto thy seed. I have caused thee to see it with the eyes, but thou shalt not go over there. Thank you for the reading of the scripture. Now, first of all, before I teach you, I want you to understand the meaning of Pisgah. The word Pisgah means a place that you see, but you don't get. A place that you see, but you don't get. We have a lot of people right now who are watching me, and others are even here, where you are seeing things in faith, in your prayers, but you're not getting them. Because you are moving or you're experiencing a Pisgah. A Pisgah, it is a mountain where people see miracles. People perceive things to happen, but they don't happen. Someone can even tell you, I will employ you, and they don't employ you. They can even tell you, you'll be promoted, and you don't get promoted. They can even propose you or marry you, and they don't marry you. In fact, at Pisgah, it is a place where people have visions of projects, and they actually see, I will do this, I will do this, I will do this. They can't do it because of Pisgah. Now, I want you to raise up a hand and say, Father, in the name of Jesus, whatever you make me see in my faith, I declare tonight, it will be mine. I will touch it with my hands. In Jesus' name. Amen.